violin so beautifully, and also to Matthew. So I'd just like to welcome you all formally to today, and also to all our people who are abroad or in this country live streaming on Facebook. I wish you were here, but I'm glad you're here in spirit, even if you're not here in body. So I'm just going to quickly go through the run-through so you know what we're going to do now. I'm just doing this little introduction, then Simon's going to speak to you on behalf of the PPA, and then Terry's going to give a view of Toffee Palmer from a pupil's point of view. And then we've got two short video clips, one of Gonzalo, how he made the bust, and one of him talking about his inspirations and everything. And then after that, Ben Horan, our headmaster, will do the unveiling, and then we'll have the school song. And then we'll all be very welcome to go out and watch the first, hopefully beat Wells Cathedral School at cricket. So that's the plan. And before I start, I'd just like to say my own quick thank you to Will Lee, who is our photographer extraordinaire. And Will, you've been massively helpful to me in organising this, and really this event wouldn't have been what it was without what it is without Will. So I really appreciate everything and you, all your filming, but also all your help and your positivity when we've been trying to wrangle things. So thank you very much. That was great. And so, just before I finish, Ronald Palmer's son, Jonathan, unfortunately couldn't be here today because he's working. However, he did write a tribute about his father to me, for me to read to you. So I'm just going to read that to kick off this unveiling. So this is from Jonathan. My father was a complex man made up of various strands. Painter, commercial artist, sculptor, art historian, traveller, organist, philosopher, designer, builder, magician, and of course a teacher. It is a tribute to him that there are men here today who, over 40 years ago, were once his pupils at Briar Park. A few years ago, my curiosity of the past led me to investigate Friends Reunited via the internet. I stared at the screen and read, "Anyone remember Toffee Palmer, the art master?" I had no choice but to reply, declaring that I indeed did remember him, very well in fact. It then became possible to renew contact with a number of old boys, and their clear memories of him were set out in email messages that I received. In many ways, he did not conform to the traditional idea of a teacher, but he did command huge respect. Passion, enthusiasm, commitment were hallmarks of his approach, and the art department at Prior Park was lively and pioneering. I know because I was part of it myself in the sixth form. He enjoyed the stimulus of young minds and missed it terribly when he retired in 1976. As Sidney Ash said at the time, to Mr. Palmer, his pupils were everything. His dedication to them was total. His joy in their successes, both at school and beyond, was deep and unaltered. He took into the classroom his own experience, derived from visits to Europe, especially Italy, at a time before package tours and motorways had evolved, a time when you waved frantically if you saw a GP plate on another car. One of these trips was in a Humber Hawk with an ex-army tent, and another in a Hillman Minks estate. And without realising it at the time, I was receiving a rich cultural education. Alongside his art teaching, he also decided to develop choral singing with the same infectious energy and confidence. And over many years, there were a number of major concerts culminating in the 1974 Jubilee. And as if this wasn't enough, he was also the organist and choir master of St. Alphege Church, Oldfield Park, for nearly 20 years. When he retired, he clearly missed his teaching and the contact with young minds more than anything else and decided to move away from Bath. He embarked on a series of house moves, all of which did not last very long. He was still intent on realising his Cornish dream and eventually settled by himself at the quarries, his final home at Treen, near Land's End. And this became his final project, and in the early 90s, he defiantly remained active, erecting walkways, building massive stone walls, and constructing substantial abstract sculptures in resin. When it was clear that he was unable to care for himself anymore, he became a resident at Trevela Manor Nursing Home in Penzance, in 1996 until he died, age 91, in 2004. As a child, I remember he could hardly wait until my legs were long enough so he could start to teach me the organ. But that was not to be, and my own career in music began as a cellist inside the world of youth orchestra. Sons might wonder how much of their father they have inherited, and there is no doubt that I received a strong influence from him. I shall conclude by offering my personal thanks to Gonzalo for creating his outstanding memorial to Ronald Palmer. And in the words of old boy Philip Sales, he was such a great teacher and a good man. So I'd like to hand over to Simon Morgan, PPA President.
Thank you, Sir Evan Rees. As probably we've all come to do, I've been looking back on my time here as a student back in when I started in 67. And I can recall that if one wanted to study science, English, history, modern languages, I'll leave out geography, then the fields of opportunity were pretty lush and green. But if one wanted to study the performing arts, it was frankly a desert. And in that wilderness, there was one oasis, and that oasis was Ronald Toffee Palmer. His ability to introduce all of us to art, and particularly, I think it's fair to say, his main sort of strength was music, was nothing short of legendary. And his art room at the bottom of the science block there was a real haven. A sort of treasure trove, and going in there was never boring. He was an early user of visual aids, slides, music. We even danced at some stage, I seem to remember. Quite a lot, why, I don't know. Then, of course, there was the kiln he had down at the bottom where we all made our first ashtray and terracotta figure. And he was able, but I think his greatest gift, certainly as far as I was concerned, is his ability to express the history of art. He would take you from the Renaissance greats through the Baroque, Constable landscapes, the Impressionists, introduce us all to Cubism and Modernism. And if nothing else, the reason why I can answer questions on that on University Challenge is from the education that I received from him. So I'd like, on behalf of the PPA, to thank Gonzalo Sanchez for doing this, and also Will Lee and Intuas for helping to do that. And I think probably the great thing in terms of saying how wonderful Toffee Palmer was as a teacher is the fact that there's so many of us are here to pay tribute to him and other people on that. But I know that I have to be honest, he and I didn't get on that well. I remember he sent me a report which just said, inclined to be arid. Still haven't quite got it. So I will hand over to Terry Eilert, who I think will be able to give you a more fulsome picture of the great man. Terry.
Thank you, Simon. You weren't the only one who didn't get on with Toffee. Genuinely, nothing could give me more pleasure than to stand up here and to pay tribute to Toffee Palmer, which is something I've wanted to do ever since 1968 when I left the school. Shortly after leaving school, I think probably later in that year, or maybe in 1969, a group of us from the class of 68, doubtless by this time wearing our hair long and wearing military overcoats or paisley shirts or something, decided to go up to visit Toffee in his house in Bannerdown in Bath Eastern. And for us it was a pilgrimage, a sincerely meant homage to the man who had given us the keys to the world, not just of art, but of music, and also of truth and beauty. And unfortunately, we arrived at his house, and it was the day after his mother had died. And as he opened the door, the strains of Verdi's Requiem wafted out from within, and he stood there, ashen-faced, and it was basically, no, you couldn't invite us in. Thank you, goodbye. And we trespassed into his private world. That's the last time I ever saw Toffee. We had trespassed into his private world. I don't know that he would have invited us in even if his mother hadn't died. I suspect he wouldn't. because he had his own life to lead. But anyway, he'd already invited us into the world of art and music, which is not a secret world, but it's a world hidden from those who are uninitiated. And the initiation into that world was hospitality enough. Ronald was born in 1913, the same year as my dad. He was a graduate of the Royal College of Music. He was an ARCM. He was the husband of Mary, whom none of us ever saw, and the father of Jonathan, Pongo, whose tribute was just read out by Emma Lou, and of Gabrielle, his daughter, whom we also never saw. The whole family converted to Catholicism in 1955, which was the year that Toffee came here to Prior to start to be a teacher. He was the head of art and sometime head of music between 1955 and 1975. He joined the school at the age of 42. He left at the age of 62 to go into retirement. Now, people always say, why was he called Toffee? And the answer is there was a brand of toffees, of confectionery, called Palmer's. So he was known as Toffee Palmer. I mean, that's gone now. That brand has disappeared. And he was steeped, as we've heard from his son Jonathan, in the appreciation of art, architecture, and music. The Humber estate car that was always parked outside St. Paul's was eventually replaced by a VW camper van so that he could make his trips to Siena and Florence and Ravenna more cheaply and more affordably. In the school at Prior, he ran a formidable art room. I think we can all agree on that. And art lessons were eagerly anticipated, not because art was easy or because Toffee gave us an easy time. On the contrary, his approach to the histories of art and architecture, which were crucial, they were essential components of the Oxford and Cambridge syllabus, so they couldn't be skipped, was rigorous, while his conduct of our practical work was exceptionally disciplined. There was no messing around. He insisted that we leave our cynicism and our boyish pranks at the door, and we only brought our full attention and our openness to discovery into the art room. His job, he believed, I think, was to draw something out of us, not to drum something in. And the art room was his domain. God forbid that anyone opened the door without his invitation. Even the headmaster wouldn't do that. You know, you wouldn't dare set foot inside the door without his invitation. When we were working in the art room, he would play music on the gramophone, and we became familiar with the Corelius Suite, the New World Symphony, Sibelius' Second Symphony, as well as music by Stravinsky, Debussy, Bach, and Verdi. Those are the ones that I remember. And when work was going well, he would break into song himself. He would hurry from boy to boy, giving intense one-to-one tutorials in technique, having us all gather around while he created a stage design with burnt umber, blue wash, a brush and a felt nib, all done in 2 minutes. And then he would scrunch it up, throw it in the bin, and send us all back to our workstations to carry on with our work. I actually retrieved one of those little doodles of Toffee's, a stage design, from the bin, and I subsequently sprayed it with water and ironed it out flat and framed it, and it remains in my study at home in North London to this day, because I'm so proud of him and so proud of it. The blinds were pulled down, the lights went out, as he took us through our paces in art history. The slides were his own, as were the extensive notes, each of us had his own duplicated copy. We had a green folder for art history and a black folder for the history of architecture. And to this day, Toffee's art history notes are the best introduction to the subject that I've ever come across, blending the technical and aesthetic developments from Cimabue to Duchamp. Often, his classes were accompanied by impromptu musical illustration. He would dance over to the piano and play some Bach fugue or something, or some contrapuntal music to demonstrate a cultural trend that he was trying to explain to us in front of the blackboard. He was a veritable whirlwind of enthusiasm and commitment, all of it underpinned by meticulous preparation and organization, which we largely didn't notice. But actually, every time we turned up in the class, everything was ready. And by the time we left, everything was tidied away. I mean, he was just a meticulously well-organized guy. He had no discipline issues at all. At any level of the school, there were no discipline issues in the classroom. He impressed upon us that art was far too serious for us to mess around, and we didn't mess around. He also had great ambition. One day in the classroom, he drew two horizontal lines on the blackboard. Now, Ben may tell us this is an old teacher's trick, that you draw a line at the bottom of the blackboard, as Toffee did, and point to it and say, this is the level of achievement required to pass the exam. And then he would look at the line at the top of the blackboard and say, and this is the level you've already reached. Yeah? So he instilled in us enormous confidence. And the result of that was he had great exam success. And 20 years ago, believe it or not, I did an analysis of exam results at Prior Park. 40% of Toffee's candidates got the top mark, grade A. In those days, grade A was the most you could get. The only teacher who came close to that, who equaled that actually, was Vic Ferguson, the teacher of biology, also an excellent teacher. 40% got grade A's, which is pretty much something, I think. But to Toffee, exams weren't everything. I'm not even sure they were all that important to him, because, as we all know, he tended to disdain conventional judgments. He did tend to indulge his favourites a bit, and his favourites are the ones who could draw and paint well. But he had an enormous impact on the non-art boys as well. I was an art boy, but the non-art boys were also tremendously impacted by him. Even Tim Heine here from my year, Tim, rather like Simon, didn't get on with Toffee, and Toffee didn't get on with Tim. But Tim's here, yeah? And he's here because his love of art history, which is deep and long, was inspired by Toffee. I had a drink with my brother in a pub recently. My brother wasn't an art boy, he couldn't draw to save his life. And because I was coming here today, I asked my brother, what did you think of Toffee Palmer? And he said, Toffee created an atmosphere that included everybody, that was enthusiastic and sometimes very exciting, and there was no fear. I think it was a lovely recollection of a teacher who wasn't even that important to my brother. As we all know, he directed the annual carol service, he ran the choir, he wrote the school song, he produced annual orchestral concerts, and he put on an annual art show. In both fields, in music and in art, he insisted upon the highest standards. I can't illustrate the art, unfortunately, it's all gone, it's all dispersed, and there are no photographs, none that I'm aware of. But I did look into the digital archive, and I found in the digital archive the programmes of his annual concerts. In 1959, 4 years after, it was Fauré's Requiem. In 1960, it was Elgar's The Apostles, Edmund Rubra's Gloria and his Agnus Dei, Vaughan Williams' Benedicite. In 1961, Marcello's Allegretto for Strings, Mozart's Mass in B-flat, Palestrina's Missa Brevis. In 1962, Vaughan Williams' Five Mystical Songs, Bach's Ascension Cantata, and his motet, Jesus, Priceless Treasure. In 1964, Vaughan Williams' setting of Psalm 90, Lord, Thou Hast Been Our Refuge. Herbert Howells' Psalm 42, Like as the Heart, and Benjamin Britten's Hymn to the Virgin. In 1965, he put on a program mostly secular music. Gibbons' The Silver Swan, Frank Bridges' Peter Piper, Purcell's Air and Rondo in D minor, Gounod's Faust. Also, he found space for Bach's Jesu, Joy of Man's Desiring. In 1966, it was César Franck's setting of Psalm 150 and Victoria's Kyrie. In 1974, it was a program of Purcell, Schubert, and Vaughan Williams. A mix of old, Palestrina, Victoria, classical, Mozart, and contemporary, Rubra and Vaughan Williams. Of course, this wasn't all Toffee's own work. He did rely upon those he corralled into helping him. Mr. Williamson, you may remember, taught us to play the violin. Mr. Williamson would coach the string section. Early on, Mr. Clohessy would coach the brass and woodwind section. Toffee was helped by members of staff who could play, like Brother Shreenan, Brother Miller, Mr. Hunt, and of course, Nora Hodges, who played the piano. He even on occasion co-opted the organist from St. Michael's Twerton to come in and bolster the school orchestra. And he got countertenors from Bath Abbey one time to come in and sing with the choir. And sometimes he got old boys to come back and to help out and to participate. Such was his infectious enthusiasm that I imagine it would be very hard to turn him down. Now, believe it or not, these annual concerts at Prior Park were reviewed in the Bath and Wilts Evening Chronicle, a newspaper which has changed its name more often than I've had. The Bath and Wilts Evening Chronicle reviewer, I will just quote you some bits from the reviews. It's refreshing to find a school with sufficient courage and imagination to perform a work such as Fauré's Requiem. The choir of 40 voices was beautifully balanced. The solo sung by Anthony Good. Adrian is here. Anthony, unfortunately, no longer with us. Anthony obviously had a beautiful voice. Proved a most moving experience. The intonation of the competent orchestra was surprisingly good and did not offend the most sensitive ear. We know what he's talking about there in terms of school orchestras. Or again, the daring experiment of including the harpsichord, this was in Vaughan Williams' Five Mystical Songs, proved to be completely successful and gave some beautiful touches of colour. On the performance of Rubra's Agnus Dei, the critic wrote, "The boys proved that they have a good understanding of the modern idiom and also captured the poetic quality of this sometimes elusive piece." Or again, it would have been unheard of a few years ago for a school choir and orchestra to undertake a work of the magnitude of Vaughan Williams' Benedicite. Mr. Palmer refuses to be daunted, a splendid effort against impossible odds. And finally, of the Britain, the critic noted, the choir of some 35 voices had an ethereal quality about it which left an unforgettable impression of spiritual exaltation. All of this was done in a school, a tiny school, of 270, sometimes 280 boys. About 40 to 42 in each year, from ages of 11 to 18. It was a mixed ability school, it was non-selective, it was a tiny comprehensive, and Toffee had this vast ambition as to what could be achieved in both music and in art. I sang in the choir. I remember singing, I used to stand next to John Evans, we used to always stand together. I used to open my mouth and he used to sing. I sang in the choir. I remember singing Palestrina, was a great favourite of Toffee. A lot of plain song. Herbert Howells, Parry, even some Verdi. We loved it. We loved being in the choir, and we loved him. Jonathan, in his little encomium, noted that his dad didn't conform to the traditional idea of a teacher, although he did command huge respect. Actually, I don't think this is entirely true. I think Toffee conformed exactly to the idea, the traditional idea of a teacher, but it was the idea of a great teacher, which is what he was. In education, he did exactly what an educator is supposed to do. He inspired enthusiasm for his subject. He instilled in us, all of us, not just the art boys, a lifelong interest in art, architecture, and music. His philosophy was rooted in a commitment to truth and beauty. Beauty is truth, truth, beauty. That is all ye know on earth and all ye need to know. That's what John Keats wrote, and that was Toffee's belief. And it was the most fervently held belief of those of us who came under Toffee's spell. The consolations of religion waned for many of us in our teens. I was certainly one of those. And Toffee provided substitutes in art, music, architecture, and by extension, literature and poetry. And these became my religion. I was one of the art boys, and I went on to art school after being at Prior. But these judgments of mine are echoed by the comments made about him in the school magazine. I went to the digital archive, looked up things, and Toffee is described variously as different, unorthodox, outstanding, and enthusiastic. He was, of course, and this was hinted at in Jonathan's contribution, a complex man, we all know that. As well as enthusiasm and energy, he appeared nervous sometimes and unsure, and we all had the impression that he stayed a long way from the staff room. I'm not quite sure what that was about. He could certainly be scathing about the school, and of course, he was totally uninterested in sport, which was a bit of a disadvantage at Prior. In my trawl through the archives, I noticed that he is sometimes mentioned in the obituaries of alumni from that era. And one example will suffice, and this was actually written by Rory Keegan, who's sitting here. Rory wrote an obituary of Michael Burton, a friend of ours who died some years ago. And Rory wrote, "Michael was a visionary artist and craftsman. He pursued an unconventional school career, perhaps to the frustration of the brothers. Fortunately, our inspiring art teacher, Ronald Palmer, recognized Michael's extraordinary ability and nurtured it and him with characteristically impish enthusiasm and fiercely high standards, winning Michael's lifelong gratitude." It's a gratitude that many of us share. When we were organising the first reunion of our year, my year is 1968 and 2002, Toffee, unbeknown to us, was still alive. And I would have loved to have paid tribute to him then, but we missed the moment. I'm really pleased to pay tribute to him now. And I'd like to thank Gonzalo and Will and Declan and Emma Lou and all those others who've been involved in making this day possible. They have allowed me, at last, to say a public thank you to the man who provided the signpost for me through life.
Dear Prior Park and alumni, it is a special occasion, a day for Mr. Palmer. I must apologise for not being there, but my obligations here have not allowed for it. The alumni relations have also organised a reunion of the lads from my year. Well, no longer lads. Thank you, Emma Louise. We are celebrating a tribute to an extraordinary man. His memory has always been with me, and I have long wanted to make a portrait of him. Still, it was the contact with other alumni that made me think that I should offer it to our school. And from there on, a simple fancy took on a grand course. We must thank two people in particular for this. First, Woodley, for adopting the project and offering it to Prior Park. And then, to Declan Rainey, for backing it, understanding that it was meaningful to Mr. Palmer's past pupils. Both of these gentlemen have guided this venture and made it come to life. And what may have been a plaster bust turned into a bronze one on a marble plinth. It would have remained at my studio, but now it is displayed in a significant hall at Prior Park. The evolution of an idea into a project like this is rarely casual. Need pushes it. The will behind a general consensus is the driving force. Shortly after takeoff, one old pupil wanted to give financial support to have the portrait cast into bronze. Afterwards, others wanted a good display for it, and they commissioned a marble plinth for this purpose. Thus, we must thank all these people that loved and respected Mr. Palmer. For they gave, as we may say today, the vibes that made this happen well. The nature of this tribute is proof that we honour a special man. I don't think I was aware of his greatness when I was with him. Still, at the time, I felt his classroom was a refuge, a place where I experienced hope and happiness. In it, I made plans for a future career, and I believed that what would seem unlikely was possible. It was a sense of blind faith. No formula would make a person inspire such virtues. By this inspiration, though, it is plain that we stood before a very noble soul. We learned from him that art was a way of life, not only a past time. His words have rung in my ears throughout all my life, insisting on clarity and precision in drawing, he would advise, "Thus I see it, thus I do it." Other phrases like the boatiness of boats served to express the attraction of subjects. As a demanding teacher, he would say, "It is nearly, but not quite. There are many. Don't be over sentimental. Now we're getting down to business." His explanations only naming a few of how Van Gogh suffered, or how the Pope ordered Michelangelo, who was a sculptor, to paint the Sistine Chapel, Monet's love of light, Paul Klee's and Seurat's intellectual approach to painting. All these things shaped a profile of art in our minds. Mr. Palmer was an artist of his time. He knew the art world through contact with it. Thus he transmitted a first-hand experience. Still, it does not explain why he was such an influential teacher. He had another talent. He was also a musician, and he brought music into his class, blending it with the general feeling of his pupils. In this, we may understand how he was concerned with the essence of artistic activities. Moods and circumstances that matter to people. Thus, it was not Beethoven's Fifth or Ravel's Bolero, but what was appropriate, maybe Palestrina, Debussy, Handel, Fauré or Corelli, among others. Beethoven's Fifth too, and Ravel's Bolero. Mr. Palmer has had a deep influence on my work. To understand this, we must go beyond the appearances. It would seem that an artist committed to the first half of the past century would be in a different sphere to one devoted to the study of nature. It is in these circumstances that our teacher proved to be open-minded and therefore generous. He did not teach us to follow styles, but to research the subjects we studied. And within this principle, any art form was valid. We did study different kinds of art, but we did it in these lines. His approach to art made it live. It shaped my interest in it and gave it a lifelong purpose. I think above all, the greatness in it was that we would never be masters, always pupils, ever learning and forever expecting a next day to carry on in our pursuit. Thank you, Ronald. Mr. Palmer, or Toffee, showed me a path I could tread. Thinking about it, I didn't know it was sculpture back then. It could have been anything artistic. You have to learn the craft after school if you want to make a living out of your art. Now 52 years on, I'm touching up a wax copy of Ronald's bust to cast it into bronze, putting wax runners and risers on it. You burn the wax out of its mould. It is quite hot. Molten bronze is much more so. And it has to be clean. When you open the furnace, it blasts out 1,300 degrees onto you. It is a moment of concentration. Pouring the bronze into a mould, you risk all the preparations. Now, only the right temperature and pouring speed will render a good cast. Easy. That's it. There is no way of knowing if casting has been successful till the mould is open. Unlike iron, bronze is brittle when red hot. It must cool down. You are impatient, but have to wait. One never knows. Fine, the cast is sound. There are no surprises now. The bronze is in your hands, and you can file, carve, and sand it. Good old Toffee. He was magnanimous.
Interesting seeing those videos, and thank you to Gonzalo for sharing his words with us. It was really special, and we wish you could have been here today, but that was the next best thing, so thank you. So I'd now like to hand over to Ben Horan, our headmaster, for the unveiling.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very, very conscious that the chairs in the Academy Hall are possibly the least comfortable chairs known to mankind. So I do not propose to talk for very long. I'd like to firstly just apologise for the fact that I wasn't able to be at lunch. I was in North Devon at a headmaster's conference and I've whizzed back to see you all today. Earlier this week was National Thank a Teacher Day. And I think in some ways it's very fitting for where we are today. There was, and I'm sure you're all on it, on the Prior Park Instagram feed, there was a video, a story that was put out by our social media team in which I think about 10 to 15 students thanked their favourite teacher at the college and said what a wonderful thing they were and how great their lessons were, and various sports teachers and art teachers and bits and pieces. Not a single one of them thanked me, but I won't. That's not the important thing. But I suppose for me it was very important seeing that and realising that in many ways this bust is the equivalent for your generation, and a much more permanent equivalent than an Instagram story that will be forgotten with the next thing that goes. Just listening here today, it's absolutely clear to me that Toffee Palmer was an extraordinary teacher. And not everybody is fortunate enough in their time in education to have somebody who makes that much of a difference to their lives. I did, and everybody in this room quite clearly did as well, which is a huge privilege. I hope that the students at Prior Park College today will all be able to look back 10, 20, 30, 40 years in the future and look back to a teacher, even if it's not me, and think what a wonderful experience that was. To hear some of the words, and I was sitting at the back writing a few of them down, passion, commitment, enthusiasm, dedication, joy, the fact that he was extraordinary, and the word greatness was used. These aren't words that you always hear used about a teacher in a classroom who makes that much of a difference to somebody's life. I hope that when we're recruiting teachers here, those are the sorts of things that we look for in appointing new teachers. I really hope fervently that I've managed to find one or two in the 3 years I've been here already who may be able to follow on and live up to that legacy that Ronald Toffee Palmer has made and the impact that he clearly had on you. I'd like to very much thank Gonzalo and Will and everybody who has contributed to donating this wonderful bust to the college. Again, conscious of the fact that the chairs are very uncomfortable, I'm going to confess one thing. I've never unveiled a bust before. I was hoping for a curtain. Because there is a really big part of me that when I realised it was just a piece of cloth over the top, that is terrified I'm going to pull it too hard in a Matador-esque fashion and the whole bust is going to come crashing down and probably end up in the mansion hall below. Fingers crossed that doesn't happen. You've obviously all seen it on the screen, but the look in person is remarkable. So, without further ado.
Yeah.